How are you all today? This is an exciting passage. Last week, Brian opened us in Acts in the beginning of chapter 1, and he was explaining to us about how Jesus had been resurrected, and he had been walking around the area for 40 days, teaching and telling about the kingdom of God. And then him and some disciples had gone to the Mount Olivet, the Mount of Olives, where he bid them farewell in his bodily form, what we call the Ascension. And the passage in Acts is left with them standing there, looking up into the sky, sort of bewildered, and two men clothed in white said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way you saw him go into heaven." So they basically said, "Why are you standing here? He's coming back." Jesus had also commanded them to go back to Jerusalem and wait, and you will receive power from on high. And so our passage today opens up in verse 12, where the men were on the Mount of Olives, and they returned to Jerusalem. It says, "Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these were with one accord, devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers." We're just going to walk through bit by bit, and I just want to share the things that I learned along the way, and then at the end, share some things I thought were quite poignant. So if everyone has their Bibles, we'll begin in Acts chapter 1, verse 12. They walked from the Mount of Olives to Jerusalem, and there's actually a passage in Luke that says that they were full of joy. So I think it's okay to sort of put our humanity on to the disciples. Their joy was fulfilled. They had put their hope in Christ, and this Christ died, and then he came back to life and then proved himself. He proved who he was. And so these disciples aren't, I don't think they're sad that Jesus is gone. I think, number one, they've realized their hope that their Savior, who did die, came back to life, just like he said he would. But second of all, they're given a promise that says, "Go and wait, and you will receive power." And so there's a kind of a buzz in the air with the disciples and those who follow Jesus. And I think it's like ordering something from Amazon, except way better, where you've paid for it, and now you're waiting. You're waiting for their parcel to come. And there's the days in between where you're like, "Is it today? Is it today? Is it today?" And they're worshiping. So there's a sense that they've met their Savior and they know their Savior, but they're worshiping. They're giving him praise and they're thanking him because not only has he left them, but he's promised them something in return, and they're excited. And so they go to Jerusalem, and it says went to the upper room. It doesn't say at upper room, but the upper room. And I sort of wonder if it's the same upper room where they had spent their last evening with the Savior. Sort of smacks of where the Last Supper was and where Jesus was saying, "Look, this is the day, or this is the evening, and tomorrow I'm going to die." But today they're in it and they're like, "No, the game has changed. He did die, but he came back to life. And now we're waiting. We're waiting for something else. We're waiting for power. We're waiting for the Spirit." So it says they went to the upper room and they were staying. And it was the disciples, all these disciples. It does number 11 of them. But then it also says they were together with the women and Mary, Just a side note, the women were probably Mary Magdalene and Mary and Martha from Lazarus and some other women. and Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there as well. And then his brothers. They're all there together. They're all waiting. I do want you to notice that they are that they're obedient. They went directly from the Mount of Olives to Jerusalem to wait. They didn't dilly-dally around. They didn't go to visit other towns. They were deliberate about their actions. They went from the mountain to Jerusalem. And also, there's a time period. We know that Pentecost, from the Jewish tradition, is 50 days after the... Oh my gosh, 50 days after... Huh? Passover, thank you. Gosh, that's embarrassing. 50 days after Passover. So Jesus died on the weekend of Passover, and he was with them for 40 days. We know that from Scripture. And so there's this 10-day gap where they're just told to wait. And they're actually probably preparing for a Jewish feast of Pentecost, Shavuot. I can't remember what it was. I didn't write it down. My Hebrew is a little rusty. But basically, the Hebrews were going to celebrate when the law came to Sinai. So they're preparing for that. They're probably eating loads of dairy and studying their Bible. That's sort of how they celebrated. So we'll just keep going in... There's some great stuff I wrote down, but it just doesn't fit right now. In verse 15, it says, "In these days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of persons was about 120 people." That's more than we've got here, actually. We need the students back. "And said, 'Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spake beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who become a guide to those who arrested Jesus, for he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in the ministry.'" So the brothers and their congregation are around them, and they're likely very, it says they're devoted. I'd say they're devoted to Scripture and they're devoted to prayer. And I wonder, is Peter looking around and he just says, there's a space here where there shouldn't be a space. There were 12 of us. There were always 12 of us. And there's a space where there shouldn't be a space. And after reading the Word, the Bible, the Old Testament, and reading through the Psalms and devoting themselves, it was likely that he was seeing, reading, and probably remembering the Scriptures in the Psalms about Judas leaving a place. He says it in verse 20, he says, "For it is written in the book of Psalms, may his camp become desolate and let there be no one to dwell in it." He's probably read that over the course of the 10 days and he's remembering it now and says that there's a problem here. And he's remembering the scripture and he's quoting the scripture. We remember from Brian that David was not only a king but a prophet. And so the Psalms that he wrote were full of life. They were written by the Spirit. And so Peter is remembering the Psalms and remembering what was said about Judas. We'll talk more about that because that Psalm is actually quite poignant and we'll come back to it. But anyway, he's standing up among all of the people and he says that we have an obligation. We have to fill the space that was left. Judas had become a guide for those who arrested Jesus. I don't know if it's necessary, but we'll say anyway that Judas was one of the disciples who betrayed Jesus. He actually, at the appropriate time, went and got the leaders of the synagogue and led them to Jesus while he was praying and with a kiss identified him so that he might be arrested and killed. We shouldn't always project ourselves onto the disciples, but Peter probably is remembering the moment that he denied Christ. And Judas, probably, He's probably thinking, I understand the weakness that Judas had. I understand that Judas saw the opportunity, he saw the money, and I don't know what he was thinking, but I know my own weaknesses, Peter's thinking. I know how I denied the Christ. And it's unfortunate that Judas chose the path that he did. I found it peculiar that in reading the account of Judas, Matthew 26:50, Jesus actually calls Judas friend. He says, friend, do what you must. And I don't think our Lord was given to sarcasm. I believe Christ fully loved Judas, even in the height of his treason. Peter probably remembers that. But Judas went his own way. Peter remained with Christ even after his denial, and Christ reinstated him. In verse 18, there's a narrative regarding Judas. It says, now this man, Judas, acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called, in their own language, Akeldama, that is, the field of blood. It's a bit of a gory recollection of the life of Judas. But anyway, Judas was given 30 pieces of silver to betray the Christ, and there's some different stories on what happened to 30 pieces. Some say that Judas repented and threw the money back to the temple. This recollection says that he went and purchased a bit of land. I would say that since Luke is our dear historian, this is probably the more accurate version, but there's some debate as to which one is which. You could say the temple priest bought the land, and they did, so he sort of vicariously bought the land. There's different ways to explain it, but in this one, he bought the land. And he went out to the land, and it said that he, falling headlong, burst open in the middle, and his bowels gushed out. Sorry, I'm not going to read that again. Peter, when he denied the Christ, he stuck around, and Christ reinstated him. And Judas, from the other passage, we get that he repented, that he was full of grief for himself. And I don't want to make it gory, but Judas was doomed. Christ says he was doomed. Christ called him the son of perdition, the man who was going to go into nothing. And God had a purpose for Judas in his life, and I'm afraid I can't explain, you know, God loves everyone. Where did Judas go? But it seems that Judas was doomed. And I do wonder a little bit if in verse 18, having denied Christ and sent him out to be killed, if Judas was so full of grief that this is a physical manifestation of being utterly abandoned by God. There was no hope for this man who had sold out the Savior. Even Jesus himself said it would be better if this man had not been born at all. But this is a man who, full of grief, had gone out, purchased a field, and died. I believe it to be a physical manifestation of utter separation from the Lord. Verse 20, Peter quotes the Psalms. It says, for it is written in the book of Psalms, may his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office. Now, if you put your finger in Acts, I want to take us to Psalm 69, because Psalm 69, besides being a passage that alludes to Judas, is so full of Christ that it deserves to be read. I have some segments that you can kind of follow along with, but Psalm 69 speaks a lot about this, about the Lord and his time in Jerusalem. Psalm 69, 1 through 4 says, "Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in deep mire, where there is no foothold. I have come into deep waters, and the flood sweeps over me. I am weary with my crying out, my throat is parched, my eyes grow dim with waiting for my Lord. More in number than the hairs on my head are those who hate me without cause. Mighty are those who would destroy me, those who would attack me with lies." It's reminiscent of Christ's last day on earth, the impending doom growing above him, coming up to his neck. He cries out asking, "Lord, even if it's your will, let this cup pass from me." Meanwhile, secret men are meeting in secret places, conspiring against him, telling lies how they might trap him. Judas now sneaking through the night, gathering money, leading priests. Verse 7 and 8. "For it is with your sake that I was born with reproach, that dishonor has covered my face. I have become a stranger to my brothers, an alien to my mother's sons." Jesus now, in fact, has borne reproach. All of our sins are being poured onto his shoulders as he's going up to the cross. All those who have loved him have abandoned him as well on the day of Calvary. Verse 21, "They gave me poison for food, and for my thirst they gave me sour wine to drink." We know that Jesus hanging on the cross was given gall, a bitter drink. In the passage about Judas, 22 through 25, "Let their own table before them become a snare, and when they are at peace, let it become a trap. Let their eyes be darkened so that they cannot see, and make their loins tremble continually. Pour out your indignation upon them, and let your burning anger overtake them. May their camp be desolate. Let no one dwell in their tents." Likely Peter was reading through that passage in the 10 days between the Ascension and between Pentecost. And as he was reading, he was remembering our Lord and then also remembering the atrocities that Jews had committed. And then he remembers Psalm 109, 6 through 8. It's not very long, you don't have to go there. Psalm 109, 6 through 8. "Appoint a wicked man against him. Let an accuser stand at his right side." So Judas is the wicked man. "When he is tried, let him come forth guilty, and let his prayer be counted as sin." So no longer listen to Judas. "May his days be few, and may another take his office." So as they're studying, Peter's reading these passages that David had written and is thinking, this must be what the Lord is saying to us. His space does need to be filled. And so he takes it upon himself to say, we need to fulfill the scriptures. And so, verse 21. "So, one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." And they put forward two, Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also called Justice, and Matthias. So you have a massive group of people here. You have 11 disciples who are now apostles, transition. They're all standing there, and they're waiting, and they've done diligence. They said, we need to pick someone from us who was there from the beginning. Now, what I like is that from the beginning, he says, from Jesus' baptism all the way through his resurrection and likely his ascension, which had just happened. So there's 120 people sitting there, and they pick two people who had been there from the beginning. Like, can you understand? Like, they've been walking with Jesus for 3 years. They were there at his baptism. They were there during his miracles. They were likely one of the 70 that had been commissioned, so they had a pre-Holy Spirit rally when they went out preaching the good news, telling everyone the kingdom was near, and they were given authority to heal people. They were likely one of those people. They were there in Jerusalem when Jesus was crucified, and they're there now. They're there now, meaning they didn't defect. They didn't leave the cause. They were there from the beginning. through when it was very, very hard. And so here they are all in the room, and the people say, well, the people don't say, but there's two here that are qualified, Justus and Matthias. And so they bring them to the disciples, and the disciples have listed out the qualifications. Here they are, fully qualified to fill the space that Judas had left. So the disciples have done the legwork. They've done the duty of finding someone and electing them, and I've gotten it down to two. I just want to say a few brief things about these two. These two have been witnesses, and yet not in the inner circle. They've been sort of hanging on the edge of this beautiful, powerful ministry, on the edge but not in it, and yet committed. So even though they weren't the ones that Jesus took to the top of the mountain where he transfiguration, they're still committed. They're hanging on the edge of this glorious life. And we know in hindsight that the election of this position is likely a position of martyrdom. And yet, here they are willing. The next verse is a little peculiar. It says, starting in verse 24, when they had prayed and said, "You, Lord, know the hearts of all. Show which of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell to Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. So the disciples have done their work, and they said, "This is the people who are qualified, but we need something else. We want the Lord himself, who called the disciples in the beginning, we want him to choose the 12th disciple." And they prayed, I'm sure, honestly and earnestly. They did the outside inspection. What they needed was an inside inspection. And we know from Scripture that God is a God of hearts. Psalm 16, oh no, that's not the one. Jeremiah 17:10. "I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind." So they're calling out on the Lord, the examiner of hearts, and says, "Which of these do you want?" And they use a very old-fashioned method of decision-making. They cast lots or draw lots. Typically, it was kind of like a bunch of little bones or dice, and you roll them or throw them, and you are able to discern your answer out of them. I don't think people know exactly how they worked, but it does remind us of the Urim and Thummim, which the high priest used to carry in the Old Testament to divine the will of God. And so it smacks of that, but they're trying to make a decision. And so they cast lots, and the lots fall to Matthias, and they add him to their number. So the disciples were very dutiful, and then they prayed, and Lord picked Matthias, and they figured that they found out what the Lord wanted by casting lots. That was not eloquent. But this is what I want to say, and this is the best transition. This is the last time lots are ever cast to hear from the Lord. This is the last time an intermediary is ever needed to know what the Lord is doing and what the Lord wants. Because what is about to happen is a game changer. Everything changes. Chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost, which was the giving of the law in the Old Testament, arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Pentecost was a celebration of the giving of God's law. Pentecost this time is a celebration of God giving himself. Freedom. I wrote down freedom. The disciples were dutiful, even the previous chapter. They were obedient, and they followed the law very well. But something is about to happen, and has happened to them now, that is going to bring them into a new stage of knowing their God. In Mount Sinai, when the people were gathered around the mountain, there was thunder, loud noises, and fire. And that is exactly what they experienced here. Except the people weren't around the mountain, they were in the room. And the noise and the fire was in and around them. This is ultimately Emmanuel, God with us. This is Christ's Spirit. This is not something different. This is Jesus coming back to be with his disciples, to be with his children. It says that suddenly there came from heaven. The word for heaven there isn't the sky or even the universe. The word for heaven there is literally the place where God lives. Some other place that you can't get to from here. And it was opened up, and this is where this presence came from. Jesus was taken up into heaven, the place where God is, and amazingly enough, the place where God is opens up and sends the Spirit of Christ back to us. It says they were all together in one place, devoted to prayer and fellowship. I believe they were expectant. This is the gift that Christ had promised. Jesus said, go and wait. And we know day one, day two, is it here yet? Is it here yet? Is it here yet? And finally, this is the day they're here. It says they were devoted. They weren't just passively waiting. I saw this really brilliant, I didn't quote it. Mike's going to be angry. McLaren was his name. He's a writer and a commentator. He said, Perpetual occupation may be more of a loss of time than devout waiting. Read Facebook. With hands folded, because the heart is wide to open to receive the power which will fit it, which will fit the hands for better work. The disciples weren't dilly-dallying. They weren't wasting time. They weren't occupying themselves with various tasks. They were devout and waiting for this power from on high. And they were all together. They were already practicing unity before it was necessary. And the Spirit comes, a very loud wind, which was apparently loud enough to draw the attention of nearly the entire city. And then fire resting above them. It doesn't say 12 tongues. I speculate that it was 120 tongues of fire, everyone in the upper room. And it says they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So the Spirit is going around giving tongues to people, giving people other languages to talk and to speak. And it's commotion and it's crazy. And people are starting to draw a crowd. So we'll go to verse 5. It says, now there was dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished. Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? Are they normal people? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native tongue? And there's a massive list. And as I read the list, it actually goes from far east to kind of like Rome. So it names them Parthians, which is kind of like modern day Turkmenistan, and then Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, which is current Iraq and Iran, Judea, we know where that one is, Cappadocia, which is sort of Turkey, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, those are all Turkey and sort of Eastern Europe, Egypt, which is great that they're from Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and then also visitors all the way from Italy, from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, those people who aren't Jewish but practice Jewish traditions, and then Cretans, the little island out in the middle of nowhere, and Arabians, which are the peninsula kind of south of Israel. It says, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God, and all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others, mocking, said, they are filled with new wine. So all these devout Jews, there's a very loud noise, and they're devout Jews because they're in Jerusalem on Pentecost, so they're remembering the giving of the law, they're celebrating Pentecost, and as they're up early in the morning, they're eating their dairy and they're reading the Torah, and suddenly it sounds like a hurricane is upon the city. And What is this thing happening, you know, devout Jew from Crete? What is this thing that's happening? And, you know, you kind of perk your head up and then you go outside and you don't see anything, but the noise is deafening. And so they go over and there's a crowd of people around this upper room. Imagine thunder and fire on a mountain, a crowd of people around who are trying to figure it out. Very reminiscent of Exodus. And so all these people, these devout Jews, are gathered around looking up, and they're amazed because they see people from Jerusalem, people from Galilee, people from the area, speaking in languages that they shouldn't be knowing, especially such diverse languages as this. Maybe a little bit of Greek, you know, but not languages as diverse as this. And then it says, you know, the scripture does say that there is tongues of flames above the people in the upper room. And so can you imagine, like, seeing little, I don't know, glowing orbs, glowing tongues of fire above these people who are yelling out praises to God? These people, what does it say? It says they're in awe, doesn't it? Amazed and astonished. They're amazed, but amazed isn't good enough. They're astonished as well. Like, it's sort of affecting them. What is going on? But this is it. This is the Spirit come to earth. This is God saying, do you remember Babylon, where man's pride tried to get to God and scrambled all your languages? Well, this is God coming to man, unifying you all despite your languages. And these people are amazed. And then it says, it says they were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? So they're remembering the giving of the law, and this is the same day that the law was given several thousand years ago. What does this mean? Like, something, there's something here. They remember Babylon. They remember the giving of the law. They remember the fire in the mountain. What is going on? And they're perplexed, and they don't understand. And that's not my job to explain it to you. That's next week. But what I want to leave you with is that people are changing. People are astonished by what God is doing right now in their city, amongst them, amongst the Jews. And then it actually ends with an insult. The passage ends with an insult. It says, what does this mean? But others were making fun of him, said they're filled with new wine. These folks are drunk. But I think the mockers are a prophet as well. Because we remember in Matthew 9, 14 through 17. Oh, it's grand. We'll read it. Matthew 9, 14 through 17. When the disciples of John came to him saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? The days will come, and I believe are in this case, when the bridegroom is taken away from them. That happened last week. and they will fast. And it says they've been devout. It says, no one puts a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch tears away when the garment is worn and a worse tear is made. And then neither is new wine put into old wineskins. If it is, the skins burst and the wine is spilled and the skins are destroyed. But new wine is put into fresh wineskins, and both are so preserved. I think our little mockers were saying more than they were thinking they were saying, because this is the new wine. The disciples, these brothers, these 120, the women, all of them, they are new wineskins. Christ has saved them. And they were diligent in waiting in the upper room. And here power has come to them. Christ himself has filled them with his spirit. This is the new wine. It's the end of the passage, but there's something I want to leave you with, something for you to consider. Besides being noise and fire and tongues, something else has happened here. We are no longer servants of Christ. We have become his sons. Ephesians 1:13 through 14. I think actually I'll ask everyone to turn there. Ephesians 1:13 through 14. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. Our inheritance. The Bible says that we are brothers of Christ, brothers and sisters of Christ. And the giving of the Holy Spirit is the mark, the seal. This is the beginning of the making of a new family. This is the beginning of a church that will go into history as being brothers and sisters because of what Christ has done for them. This is not a one-off. It is a one-off event, but it's perpetual, I mean to say. We are all of us believing in Christ for the salvation of our sins, remembering that he died for us, and becoming his brothers, becoming his siblings. We are no longer servants. We don't have to have intermediary sources to know his will because he speaks to us. We don't need lots to make decisions, although I have myself and it's actually turned out great, but he does speak to us. I believe I needed lots because I forgot to ask my brothers for prayer. He speaks to us as a family. If you need something, don't try to go at it on your own. Don't do the Holy Bible flip like I've also done. Go to your brothers, ask for prayer, ask the Lord to speak to you and say to you, Lord, what is your will? That is the last time lots are cast. Let us live as children of Christ because of the Spirit that's being poured out on us. Father, I thank you that you didn't leave us as orphans. You didn't say, right, I've done all the teaching and I'm out of here. No, you did something different. You said, actually, I'm going to adopt every single one of you. And you will know you're adopted because I will send my Spirit to mark you like a last name. You get my last name. Father, and with that, we have an authority to approach the throne room, to be in heaven, that place where God resides, and be with you and hear you and experience you. Father, you didn't abandon us, but you are in fact present. And for that, I am eternally thankful. Amen.